Blessings to you all. Thank you for joining me. We are going to continue in our series, and today is going to prove to be somewhat interesting, I think. And I say that because today we're going to talk about Pharisaism. You know, it's no secret that Jesus really took the rabbis to task in his day. This Pharisaical, the scribes and Pharisees, that group, he unleashed on them. I mean, you want to talk about vehemently attacking someone. I mean, he unleashed words of wrath, calling them children of the devil, brood of vipers, hypocrites, blind guides, the blind who leads the blind. I mean, the speech that comes out of Jesus's mouth that is spoken against this group of people is terrifying. You know, as Christians, we're accustomed to hearing the beauty and the grace and the mercy and the healing and the power coming from his lips. A tenderness, a compassion flowing from Jesus, calling tax collectors and sinners and harlots to salvation. And it was such gentility. And that's the Jesus we're accustomed to. But there's another side to him, a side that you don't ever want to see. You don't want to be on the receiving end of how he spoke against the Pharisees. Absolutely terrifying. And you consider that behavior that Jesus displays towards these religious leaders of the day. Jesus is speaking against them as enemies. That's how Jesus talks to his enemies. I mean, that frightens me in the sense you don't ever want Jesus to talk to you like that. I want that compassion. I want that gentility. I want his mercy. I want the power of his lips speaking over my life. Because as a centurion said, just speak the word and my servant will be healed. That's what we want as Christians. We don't want the other side. Well, what was it about these Pharisees that Jesus hated that would produce such a terrifying speech? What was it that they were doing, or what was it that they weren't doing? Well, that's exactly what we're going to dig into today. See, because in the Gospel of Matthew, specifically Matthew 23, Jesus unleashes on the religious group of the scribes and Pharisees. I mean, it was merciless. One statement after another. He talks about how, they do their works to be seen by men, and they love the best places at the feast and the best seats in the synagogue. Oh, and they love to be called rabbi. And for a pretense, they make long prayers. He makes all of these statements, and all of them, when you consider these statements, what do they want? They want to be admired. They want to be acknowledged as great. They want to be looked up to. They want the people to depend upon them. They want the glory. Now, I got to tell you, God will not give his glory to another, and that's scripture. He will not do it. And so you see this personality trait, if you will, a deficient trait at that. But there's something else that Jesus pinpoints that he hates, that by definition would put them in a misguided Pharisaical camp. And so today we are going to play Who's the Pharisee? And with that said, I want to jump into Matthew 23, verse 1. Then Jesus spoke to the multitudes and to his disciples, saying, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat." What does Jesus mean by this? That the scribes and Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. What he means is that they are sitting in his position of authority and influence. See, Moses' job was to bring the law, those words that God spoke to him, bring it to the people, give the people understanding, instruct them in the ways of the Lord. And at times, Moses, yes, he would render judgment based upon God's word. And this is really encapsulates this whole idea of the scribes and Pharisees sitting in Moses' seat. They are now the ones who are supposed to teach what was taught to Moses, and i.e. they're teaching the law of Moses. They're the instructors of the law of Moses. Very, very important we understand this context. Now, you know, just as a side note, it's interesting that, you know, as they excavate Israel, they find so many things and amazing things. They're finding synagogues all over the place. And in one place, Chorazin, they found this synagogue, huge synagogue, just incredible. But one of the things they found was the seat of Moses. This huge stone seat that's literally called the seat of Moses. This was featured in the synagogue. And you know, there's a little bit of debate of whether or not, your Pharisees would sit in there or the ruler of the synagogue while rendering the judgment or even reading the Torah scroll. There's debate on this. But what there's not debate upon is that the seat was featured in the synagogue, and it's so meaningful that this concept here that Jesus is expressing in Matthew 23 was very much understood by the rabbis themselves, that they are sitting in Moses' seat. They're the successors of Moses to bring about the law of Moses to the people and to judge the people according to the law. All right, moving on, listen to this. He goes on and says, "Therefore, whatever they tell you to observe, that observe and do." Now, let's just stop. I want to be very clear. There is a specific context which Jesus makes this statement. As the rabbis sit in the seat of Moses, declaring what it says in the law of Moses, as they bring these things forward, as they bring the instructions of the Lord, what they teach, Jesus is telling his disciples, you do. And he's explicitly talking about in the context of as they preach the law of Moses, this is what you're called to do. Now take that in, because Jesus is saying, you know, to his disciples, you need to keep the law. Now, what we do know, and we know this from the very same book, Jesus is not saying that, hey, whatever these rabbis tell you to observe, that observe and do in the context of man-made tradition, of rabbinical enactments, of the traditions of men. And we know this because you go back to Matthew 15, and Jesus, he defends his disciples for not washing their hands before they eat bread, something that is so offensive to the Pharisees that, as we already talked about, would really merit excommunication. It's that offensive. You're not being Jewish if you don't wash your hands before you eat bread. Well, this is not what Jesus is talking about. Jesus's context is explicit. It's to that of the law of Moses. And when they speak in the capacity of Moses, and what is written in the law of Moses, Jesus commands that do. But then Jesus goes on and says this, "But do not do according to their works, for they say and do not do." Do you see Jesus's problem? Is Jesus's problem the law and the fact that these Pharisees and scribes are teaching the law? Is that the problem? No, that's not the problem. The problem is they're not doing the law. They're not adhering to it. They are not obeying it. They're disobeying it. They're abandoning it. They're rejecting it. And that is the problem. By definition, according to Jesus, this is what a misguided Pharisee is. Now, dropping down to verse 23, Jesus says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith." Look at that. Jesus brings three specific things to the table. When Jesus thinks about the law, what does Jesus think about? In regard, what are the most important things that we're to draw out of the law? According to Jesus, it's justice, it's mercy, and faith. Most of which Christianity doesn't connect the law to whatsoever. There's no connection of mercy with the law or faith and the law. And yet when Jesus thinks about the law, this is exactly what he thinks about. And all you need to do, if you actually study the law of Moses, if you study Genesis through Deuteronomy, you will see laws of justice, that it cultivates an environment of justice, an environment that doesn't show partiality in judgment, one that is fair, one that delivers the heart of the Lord. You will discover mercy. Lo tikom velo titor et b'nei amecha. You shall not take vengeance nor bear any grudge against the children of your people. And then it goes on, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. That is mercy. That is showing mercy. That's what the law cultivates. Forgiveness. The law actually speaks against bitterness and unforgiveness. It cultivates an environment of faith. I mean, the whole thing is about faith. It's all about righteous men of God displaying faith in God. I mean, think of Abraham. The guy is known for what? Faith. You think about Joshua and Caleb. Why did they get to go into the land of what we call today Israel, the promised land? Because of faith. They believed in the word of the Lord. They trusted in him. And so this is Jesus's takeaway from this entire situation, where these Pharisees or misguided Pharisees have completely failed in the law. They have failed in observing the law and the commandments. And that is what is offensive to Jesus. Now, dropping down even further, verse 27, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which indeed appear beautifully outwardly, but inside are full of dead man's bones and all uncleanness. Even so, you also outwardly appear righteous to men, but inside you are full of hypocrisy." Oh, and look at this, "and lawlessness." What does the Lord hate about these misguided Pharisees? Lawlessness. This is what they have. So again, I ask you, who is the Pharisee? Who is the real Pharisee? See, because when you go out into this modern day progressive Christianity, the Pharisee is anyone who would submit to the law of God and actually believe, no, we need to, as Christians, as followers in Jesus, we need to keep the law. That is what's being touted today as a Pharisee. Well, it's interesting when you actually go to Jesus's words, as he comes against these misguided Pharisees, he takes the exact opposite position. These are people that are breaking my law, that have abandoned my law. They've neglected it. They're filled with lawlessness. So who's the real Pharisee? That's all the time we have for today. May the Lord bless you and keep you.